that much pressure to you. So know that. Welcome back.
Welcome back.
Did everybody get all those videos? I sent you a bunch of videos. Good, because a lot of modeling, and especially with that, again, those two of those videos are the raw tapes for the app I'm doing. So it's just stuff. But you saw the little infant. Again, just a little pumpkin. And I just, you can reflect to a doorknob. They don't have to reflect back. There's a lot of traitizing there. I know you're wondering what I'm saying. So you are going to be a mirror with heart. You are going to reflexively reflect. You're going to reflect motor behavior. Your name is Dylan. So is it okay with you? I'm going to ask him a question. Is it okay with you that I tell the class your name? Okay, sweetie, because it's up to you and him. So this is Dylan. And you're going to reflect what Dylan is doing. You are going to reflect what Dylan is thinking, his attitudes, his beliefs, his perceptions, his motives, all that black box stuff. You're going to reflect what Dylan is feeling. You're going to reflect the traits that Dylan is evincing that would be useful at 30. So how he's being. And what are you not going to do that I just did? You are not going to ask questions. Are you? You're not going to ask questions? You're not even going to have the little figures ask questions. Because I realize that's another way. Your understandable, reflexive need to ask questions come out. You'll have the figure ask a question. So what are you going to do now? It's brilliant. The inner questioner has such a need to ask questions. Because you assume it's presumptuous. You're being very, very patient. You're assuming it's presumptuous to ask a question. To define what he's thinking or feeling. I think that's one of the reasons you ask questions. And besides, you've been doing it since you were forever. And it was done to you when you were pre-forever. So I understand why you have that need. But you're going to resist the urge. And not that questions are bad. You can do that when you want. But I want you to also learn how to do this. It looks like you're almost ready to come up here. What I'm going to have you do, I'm going to have you just sweep by when you're ready, is to come on up here. And we'll do some stuff. You ready to come up now? I am going to ask some questions for that because I got to get some orientation. You're thinking, it looks like you're kind of thinking like, oh, I'm almost ready to come up. Whenever you're ready. And if you brought any of your own toys, your own things, you're welcome to use them up there. Obviously, you'll take them home with you. And I know it would be kind of strange being in front of all these people. But my sense is what's going to happen is once you're up and put the toys in home, you'll forget about all of us. And you'll just get in the magic mind. Do you want Jan to come with you? That's up to you. Yeah. You can even crawl under the table if you want. Or you can come this way. It's totally up to you. Come on up. I know this is hard. That brave part of you is like, I am going to do this, but great for you that you know when you need some help, some support. That'll serve you well in life. That's what I mean. If you come up, you'll be able to see more. Okay, so during our time together, you can think absolutely anything you want. You're thinking, it looks like you're thinking like, wow, really, what does he mean by that? I know you're noticing that they're all coming in. You can say, actually, you're okay with what I just said, right? He can think anything he wants because you're the parent representative. So anytime you have a parent representative of the parent, you always have to have them sanctify this. You can think anything you want.
Yep.
You can feel, in that, every time I say one, you kind of go, really? What is he meaning by that? Maybe. You can feel anything you want.
Yes.
And you can do just about anything. You're basically the boss. And that's different than school or home or out there in the world. I can see you're looking at all these toys and you're kind of going, boy, a lot of stuff out there. Wonder what I might want to use first. And you're not sure there's so much there, maybe. And you're going to decide fairly soon.
You're really concentrating very hard. And you're looking all around. Good for you that you know when to kind of leap into things and when to just stay back. That will serve you well in life. I'm wondering why I'm saying that. You can look all around. You can chant. A footnote. This is a very artificial situation. This isn't therapy. If this wasn't therapy and he just wanted to sit and whatever, he wants to do that for 45 minutes, that's what we do. I have an agenda. I want to demonstrate something to you folks and I want you to practice it. So in that sense, it's not, if you want to say, fair to the ultimate spirit of all of this. It's not just child-centered, it's agenda-centered. I have an agenda here. So you'll see me, it depends what happens. But at some point I'm going to be more directive than I typically would because I need him to do certain things if I can get him to do it. So I'll be as, if it gets to that point, I'll be as child-centeredly directive as I can. But that's different. In therapy, he wants to sit like that, he wants to have a mom there, fine by me because I want him safe. Why don't you come up a little closer? There's a seat right here. Oh, actually Jan's there, but or there, wherever you can come. Okay. So again, I think you're doing a wonderful job, just kind of like perched up here going, so much stuff. And if he doesn't move fairly soon, we're going to have you to move with us. You're really thinking this through. And by the way, see where I'm sitting so I can see his face? Now, it might also be that it gets too intense for him, so I'll back off and I'll go over there. Because again, the goal is his psychological safety, that he feels like, ah. And a lot of times I'll just mirror exactly what he's doing, so I can kind of feel in the body what it feels like to be in his state. So he's like, back home. Actually, his mind's kind of tasty. You want to be so close to Jan? Yeah. You want to just snuggle to him? You want to just like, I'm going to mold to Jan. It's the Dylan Jan. Dill Jan. Dill Jan. That's what you guys are. You're Dill Jan. Janlin? Maybe you're Janlin. Dylan? That doesn't work as well. Oh, honey, pumpkin. Oh, well, this has never happened before. Oh, honey, pumpkin. That's okay. Oh, sweetheart. I'm going to switch modes. I'm going to talk to you. And then we'll see whether I've never had this happen. How do you know Dylan?
He's my nephew.
Oh, you know him. Oh, okay. So you know him very, very well. Mm-hmm. He is your
my brother's
son. Mm-hmm. And obviously brother lives here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Here.
Okay. So now what I'm going to do is very purposely, we're going to take the focus off of said lad, because obviously it's like, whoa. And so we're going to put the focus on said aunt, and get to know said lad through aunt to de-intensify. So, and you just, yeah, you sit there. So tell us his family situation. Tell us what's going on. Maybe I'll draw.
Talk a little bit about our family, people.
Let's see. We've got Dylan.
And we've got Adam.
Hang on to Dylan. And we've got
Adam's
four.
Brother.
Adam, little brother. Ta-da.
Oh, bigger brother.
Bigger brother. Oops, drew that one wrong. Right, I'll look out here. Bigger brother. Ta-da, 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 ta-da. Oh, so this is Dylan. Ta-da, 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 ta-da. Adam.
Adam is six.
Aha.
Adam's six. And
that's
mom.
Good. Good that she asked now. That would be good to ask him a question now. Why is that good to ask him a question now? What area of the brain do we want him in now? PFC. He's in limbic, right? So as much as I love Magic Mind and all that other stuff, we need his PFC because we need coping. We need pull out of affect. Got a task to do here. So that's great in that moment. Okay? Because that's exactly what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to pull him out of limbic.
And then there's a mom.
Mom.
Lucy.
Mom is Lucy. Hi. Mommy have long hair, short hair?
Does your mom have short or long hair?
Let's say longish hair.
Longish. La 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 la. Okay, and her name is Lucy.
Lucy.
And that's mom.
Yeah.
Okay.
And what about dad's name? Dad's Ryan.
We got Ryan. Is Dad bigger than Mom?
They're about the same size.
Okay. And that's Ryan, and that's Dad.
And your kitty
cat. Aha, I was wondering if there's any pets.
Meow.
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 Winona. Winona. The kitty, Winona. Oh, I'm such a bad kitty drawer. Oh, God. Help me. I put little kitty ears. Looks like a mouseketeer. Oh, God, that's so pathetic. I'm sorry. I've never passed the kitty drawing test. Okay, I'm sorry, Winona, I don't know how to spell Winona, but that's close enough. Winona.
Winona.
I'm going to have to put kitty here because nobody could recognize that. Okay, do we have any other animals, I'm wondering?
No other animals, huh?
No animal, that's it?
That's it.
Okay, fantastic. So we got Dylan, Adam, Mom, Dad, and Winona the kitty.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And where do they live again? Carmel Valley?
Scripps Ranch.
Scripps Ranch. Oh, that's where he has to go to Carmel Valley. They live in Scripps Ranch.
Mm-hmm.
One story, two story house?
We have stairs in our
house. Two story. Two story house?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, wow. Okay. Da 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 da. Da da da. And is Dylan's room on the upstairs or downstairs? I'm wondering where his room might be.
Upstairs?
You go up the stairs. Upstairs!
Upstairs.
Fantastic! That's upstairs, that's where we're going. Hi, everybody! Here's my room. Ta-ta. Hello.
And who else is in your room? Is it just you? Who else is in there? Could you add him? And Adam's
also in the room. Okay. Hi, everybody. It's our room. Ta-da, ta-da. Hello. Ba-bum. Oh, God. It's just a turn. Sorry, Adam. I know. Look at that. It's ridiculous.
Does that look like your brother?
It's such a bad bar.
Not so much, huh?
It's all right. It's all right to be bad at things sometimes. Let's see. And so Mommy and Daddy are also upstairs? Are they also upstairs? I'm wondering. Maybe. I'm thinking that. I'll take that as a yes. Here's Mommy. Hi, everybody. And here's Daddy. Hi, everybody. And they're upstairs, too. And I'm wondering where Winona sleeps. Meow. Meow. Meow.
Winona's.
She ever, I wonder if she, it's a, well, it's a she. I was like, I wonder if it has, she has her own room or she has.
Does she have
Where does
she sleep?
Where does
she sleep in your mom and dad's? She hasn't been in your mom and dad's room.
Oh, okay, so she sleeps here. Meow, meow. These are little kitty ears. She's just looking over the top. Meow. God, try and score this stuff. Oh, my God. Yes, ma'am.
I'm wondering if it might make Dylan more comfortable if, like, some of us sat up there, like, in a circle. Does he feel like everybody's looking at him?
I don't know. My fancy is that's almost more intense.
Yeah.
I don't know. Again, I've never had that. I've had kids being inward initially, but not to this extent. It doesn't make anything wrong with them, but it's just a different situation. The reason I'm doing this, by the way, do you understand why I'm doing this very specifically? Mm-hmm. Trying to affect the most safest, most familiar, most grounded place in the universe for him, which I would assume would be Mommy, Daddy, Winona, home. That's the associative network that I'm trying to bring forth as a safe and sheltered space, because obviously this doesn't feel that. But obviously that's not really working real effectively yet, and that's okay. But I'm very intentionally doing things. I appreciate your thought on that, but I'm thinking that would be even more, I'm not sure he's, oh, honey, I'm so sorry. Well, obviously, we're not going to continue if this continues. Do you have a sense of what? Well, I mean, here's one fantasy I have. I'm not going to torture this kid, for God's sakes. Did he communicate anything to you that makes anything clearer? No.
No, we were going to go look up at that.
Okay. See, I'd like to have him do whatever is comfortable for him.
Mm-hmm.
And then my fantasy is that you would start doing this. and that this would draw him in and out of all this. But if it doesn't,
okay.
I don't want to, yeah, this is, that's the last thing I want to do. So it's up to you, sweetie pie. I'm so sorry that you feel so, like, woo, so many feelings flooding you, pumpkin boy. And that's okay. Okay. Oh, honey, pumpkin.
What if I bring a toy from over there and then bring it here?
That'd be okay. That sounds okay. Very good. Very good. So you're going to go with him there, and you're going to... You're going to decide which toy you're going to, or toys, it's totally up to you.
I'm just talking about trucks. Let's go.
Up you go.
You
want to
sit here? Oh, look, I'm going to come. Well, watch this.
Ooh! Jan's going
to. Auntie is.
Jan's like, yes. Jan's like this huge, marvelous island in this storm. It's the moving harbor. Yes. It's like she's a big kangaroo, and you're like in her pouch. And you're like, oh, the...
I'm just going to point some things when you tell me.
There we go, we got that. You're figuring it out. And there's that one. And that, just so you know, on this, you keep doing that, and I'll do this. And this guy's got his little engine.
Ramp it up.
And it goes a little bit. Go. Go. Boy, the little quad that couldn't. I know you can. I know you can do this. There you go. And then you're going to take off. Go. Yes!
It works after all.
It does. Sometimes things take a slow start and then they speed up. Yes, yes, you caught the, yes, thank you. No, no, it's totally up to him. I don't know if he's interested in that anymore. I did want to demonstrate that. No, not that. Hello there. Not too much into that. Let me show you this.
Whoa.
This has got the little, this is a Falcon fighter. And it's got the little,
whoa.
It's got that going. Yay for you. Boy, you know how to make yourself safe. And this one does the spinneroonies.
Oh.
It's also got the blades that come out. And let's see. I'm not sure. Maybe, no, not that one. Got a pilot. Hi there.
Oh.
And it's got, well, these are a bunch of, oh, do I have this? I don't know if that's going to help any. Probably not. It's going to make me look even creepier. No, you're not interested in that, sweetie pie. We've got a lot of those. Jen, do you know what kind of things he has at home? That he...
We have your, should we grab your nap toy?
Okay, yeah, that's cool. Oh, that's cool. Do you have... Oh, so cool. What in the world is that? Yes, oh yes. You're going to grab... Probably has a name. You have wonderful ways to comfort yourself. That's really good. I can see that. You should see his face change when he had. Talk about transitional objects. Yes. Yes. Okay. We're not gonna keep doing this. This isn't helpful for him. Sweetie pie, I'm sorry. This was hard for you, honey bunny. You're very brave, and you know how to take great care of yourself in terms of being able to be comfortable, even in really difficult situations. And that will serve you well in life. It's really true. Okay. So it's up to you, Lisa, honey. Just, yeah, if you want to go back to school, your auntie will take you back to school if you want to do that. If you want to stay right where you are and just kind of keep exploring here, that's up to you. You can do that. but you can certainly leave if you want. And I thank you so much for coming. So it looks like you're not even sure what you want to do. Part of you maybe wants to stay, and part of you probably wants to go. So you guys talk amongst yourselves and figure out what you want to do. Good for you for knowing how to take care of yourself. That's just fine. Sometimes we need to stay with things, and sometimes we need to go. It's interesting. It looks like some part of you still wants to stay, because even though you can go, you're staying right now. Or maybe it's too hard even just to get up and go. I'm not sure. What, do you have a sense of what's going on from your end?
No. Yeah. School, yeah. And
oh, I'm sure.
I think it's just the big new environment.
Yeah, it's a lot of newness, and a lot of stimulus. It's like a stimulus overload.
You can just hang out, and whenever you're ready, you can go. Okay? We'll just hang out.
Okay. The bunny, if it's okay with him, might want to meet the... But it's okay, it depends if it's okay with him. What is that creature again? I don't know what that is.
Oh, he's still.
It's a unique little creature. It's its own little beingness.
Is it a llama?
Do llamas have that kind of tail? What is it? It is a llama? I'm not sure what it is. That's okay. It can be its own little unique creature.
Well, bunny is here to meet the friend and everybody.
Bunny's very shy, by the way. This bunny, it's a big deal that this bunny kind of moved over there. The bunny has a hard time sometimes in new situations.
So a tissue for me, for him, and one for me.
Tissue? Do we have tissue?
Please. Thank you, Chloe.
Let me get you a tissue. We're going to just hang with you. So do you know the name of this little pumpkin?
I don't, actually.
Oh, okay.
It's the first time I've seen this one.
Oh.
I haven't met this one yet. It's school.
That's fantastic. He's been going to the same school.
Uh-huh.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, this is the first time that I've seen him in a new environment.
Oh, wow. Right, in school or at home and whatnot. Yeah, I'm sure he loves his school and his teachers. And I bet.
Just keep petting this one.
And they on weekends they do different things. They go out. What kinds of things?
Yeah, in fact, this weekend you're going to Disneyland.
Ha! Huh. World's happiest place.
You're going to see Cars at Disneyland.
Oh yeah, they have that whole new exhibit like.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Do you love Cars?
Yeah, he loves cars.
Mm-hmm. Sometimes you go, there's a swimming pool at your place. Sometimes you go swimming. And sometimes you go to the bay.
Oh, that's cool. Here comes tissues.
Oh, yay. Auntie Jenny's a tissue badly.
Here we go. Tissues to the rescue. Thank you, indeed. Here you go, sweetie.
For you.
There you go. Where's that? Do we have a garbage? You don't really. Where's the garbage? Way back there? We'll get a garbage going. How many times is it? Oh, thank you so very much.
Thank you.
Here you go, sweetie pie. Perfect. Just drop that off. There you go. Mm-hmm. I'm so sorry this was so difficult. Who has? This is worse than getting a shot. Yeah. I say that, by the way, to make, if I can find something that's even worse, so that then this would seem less bad. So again, there's always a purpose to what I'm saying, even though it might seem very random. It's pre-thought out. But it's fine. He's going to It's just interesting that he actually didn't just hightail out of here. That really interests me. That he's the part of him that kind of wants to stay or something. Or maybe it's just hard to get up and go through all of you. It might be the other part of it, like through the gauntlet. I'm not sure. Yeah, and the other is you're so comfortable. It's so nice to have places where you feel so comfortable and safe. Totally safe. I'm wondering what kind of noise that animal would make. Meow. Meow.
Same.
Yeah. You're still curious. It's interesting how you still look at things. So, Jan, what do you think is the best? Should we just go ahead and have him go? He's very comfortable. Yeah, it looks like that's what you want to do, sweetie. That's fine, honey. That is just fine.
I won't be able to carry you up
there. Here we go. Good job. Good job, sweetie pie. You're taking great care of yourself. That's what matters. It's not about whether you play or not. Here, get yourself up. Here, let's get this out of your way. There you go. It's hard to get up.
Take your time, too.
No, yeah, you can take it up.
I'm also okay if you want to.
My fantasy, it's not a good space for him.
Yeah.
So my fantasy is that he's kind of stuck in that, because nothing has really moved him out. And I love how he's using you for comfort and all that. But my fantasy is once he leaves, he will move out of this space, and that's really better for him.
Yeah. I wonder, do you think if the tension is not on him, and then we get up and go?
Yeah, that might be that better way. So I'll just refocus. That's a good idea.
Cool.
That's a great idea, actually. We're going to, sweetie, again, I thank you so much for coming. I'm sorry it was so hard. You did a wonderful job of just taking care of yourself. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to talk to the class now. Look, you have hiccups. But thank you so much. Usually I have people applaud. We're not going to applaud for him. Nah. I mean, I appreciate it, but he needs to go to school and be back in his safer zone, which is great. But thank you for the thought. I know, it's like screens now. Sometimes when nothing else works, the screen works. But I'd rather have, but yeah, a lot of times we'll applaud when the kid leaves. We're not going to do that with this little pumpkin. It'd be way too much stimulus. Camera's going to be focusing on there, so I'm going to now take the camera off of him and have the camera go up, I guess, here. Actually, I've been teaching this since 84. I've never had this situation. I've had kids be very inward at first and then usually kind of come out. Never had this. Poor pumpkin. That's, you know, it's all about taking care of himself. So he is doing a great job in terms of finding a way to find comfort in something that's really difficult. So that part's cool. I hate to talk in front of him about him, but I think he'll be all right with that, because I don't think he'll really focus on that. Thoughts, feelings, fantasies, reactions on your parts as you watching this or saw this? Any thoughts? What do you think? Ed, you're thinking.
Well, I think that, I mean, what I was feeling is what he's feeling.
Right.
And so the interaction, I mean, I think we're all empathizing with what's going on and how difficult this must be. And so I think that's an important part of the relationship and the interaction, even if it's not to have some expected interaction, is to be there and to be supportive and for him to know that, and know that you're caring, and know that, you know, you're there for him, even if it doesn't play out exactly the way that you...
Right. My bias, as I said, is I have a very specific agenda, and you're right, and have a very specific kind of image of how I want you to be able to. And it's really about, frankly, this isn't fair, it's really about you, because I want you to have a, and everything's a learning experience. This isn't like, oh, this is disappointing. It's not, but you're right, I have a certain agenda. You also said something great about
I don't know, for those of you who read about group therapy, one of the assumptions is that every member of the group carries a feeling or theme or whatever for everybody. So he would be the identified, oh my God, this is overwhelming, part of every one of you. Because each of you feel like, oh God, I'm going to get in front of the class, I got to deal. So he, in an amplified fashion, you're kind of like, I want to hang on to somebody, I don't have to do this, can I go back to the other class or another school? So in that sense, do you need any help in anything? You got everything? What you need?
Wait.
This is yours?
Yeah, someone want to walk me to the car and then...
grab all these. Thank you, sweetie pie. Again, I'm sorry, it was hard. Here you go. Bye-bye, Dylan, man. Thank you. You betcha. Bye, honey. I'll have to go. Happy Easter egg hunting. That's right. You're off to going to get a bunch of eggs.
Yes, I think that what you said is true, because I think to a greater or lesser extent, we probably all have the thought coming here. This might be a little uncomfortable, and so this is exemplified.
Exactly.
It's
exactly. It's an amplified. Actually, it's an interesting. That I guess that's one of the lessons in all of this. That's fascinating. It's an amplified version of your own feelings. And it is true, I don't know if any of you do groups, but it is true that in groups, members will carry, or in families, or in any kind of system, the individual will carry for the whole group. If you do inpatient hospital settings, oh my God, especially if you have a borderline or something, they'll carry certain feelings and create it shifting in the whole group. But yeah, I felt so bad for him. Like, oh God, and then when he started to cry, I'm like, oh no, this is beyond iatrogenic, this is traumatic. Oh my God! Check the liability. I felt terrible.
But I also think that it was, I think that a point where it kind of shift for me was when he did have his stuffed llama.
Uh-huh.
And his facial expression changed immediately. And I felt like, okay, he's identified something that was comforting for him. And I noticed that seemed to have calmed down some of the tears and maybe create more of a safety, sense of safety for him.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's fascinating, again, how we do create a shelter in the storm. And
Jan was so
well, she's wonderful. I mean, that's fantastic. And she is a harbor for him, thank God. Imagine if you didn't. I mean, you really do. If you think about, I mean, just to kind of take this another way, I don't know if any of you phone CPS, but you know, I've done plenty of CPS calls, and sometimes they rightfully come, and they take kids rightfully out of the home. But imagine what that is, to leave your home, hopefully have at least your little llama or whatever with you, and you're going off to strangers, a new home. Hopefully you're kind or nice, but even if they're kind and nice, they're still strangers. Even if there's toys and oh my God, it's like a little micro Disneyland, it doesn't matter, man, it's inside. And you're terrified and you feel alone. God.
I have a 4-year-old client who comes from a big family of 11, and they're super tight and very enmeshed, actually, so very, very close. And she was taken away, and she played the whole thing out.
Yeah.
It was so traumatic for her,
more
traumatic than the abuse.
Yeah, that's the bind, actually. Yeah. And we are creatures of familiarity, again, predictability. And I remember one, and she was older, she was 12-ish, and she was removed and all that, but she would insist on calling her abusive alcoholic mom. One, to make sure the mom's doing okay, because again, classic child and alcoholic taking care of the parent. But the other is the predictability of the interaction. And remember, no me without a we. And if that we and one of the people is dysfunctional, it's still in the loop of defining who I am. So when you have a dysfunctional relationship defining who you are, and you're needing that almost abuse. But that feels more familiar, more comforting in a very strange way than kind person, kind environment, at least initially, until that becomes your definition of we. And that's why we seek, you know, the repetition compulsion, as good old Siggy said, even if it's negative. You have a comment.
So we can imagine with a substance abusing parent and or personality disordered parent where they are only intermittently available or supportive, how troublesome that must be for the child, that the same actions don't produce the same results consistently, and that must be terrifying.
So well said.
Because again, our brains fundamentally are totally organized to predict. And that's how we create that me, because I know you're going to act this way, then okay, and that defines me. So you're absolutely right. When that same action doesn't do that, but does sometimes, it is unbelievably unnerving. Better that it doesn't do it 100% of the time. Then you go, okay, that doesn't work, so let's try something else. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. And you talk about kids, or any of you grown up in substituting homes, that eggshellness, I'm not sure how to respond, what's going to happen this time. Remember, we notice mood shifts in a facial expression in 1/300th of a millisecond. I bet those kids in 1/600th of a millisecond, they are so trained to see where dad, where mom's at right now. Or, what's that little look? Oh my God. Because of the lack of predictability in the answer. And not only the predictability, we also want to be causative beings. One of the magics of play is it has us be a causative being. So my actions create a certain result. Well, if my actions don't create a certain result, that's an incredibly unbalanced, unstable, insecure, terrifying state to be in the world. That's well said. Actually, it occurred to me the other day that one of the things that this does in reflecting motor behavior, I see you looking at me and whatnot, is there's really three aspects. One is being a witness. See, it's not being bimonic in that state. When I see you looking at me and you're shaking your head, I'm being a witness to who you are. And we have such an unbelievable need just to have a witness, just to be seen. When I move into this, ideation, feelings, looks like you're thinking about what I'm saying, you're really kind of analyzing that one, maybe you're starting to feel a little self-conscious because I'm putting all this energy in onto you and people start, whatever's. That's in a certain way defining you. It's giving you parameters of your experience. I'm giving you some opportunity, actually to put it better, it's giving you an opportunity to define yourself. Oh, I am somebody who's right now thinking. If I do the trait, you're a very curious person. You like to learn. You want to learn everything you can. That'll serve you well in life. That's another way of defining who you are. It's still not bimonic. We're not in the same state. I'm observing you. But one is just being the witness. You're looking at me. And the other is being helping you define who you are. And then being bimonic, now we're really connecting. Each of those are levels or degrees of connection. Am I making sense? And I think that's one of the beauties of this way of being with kids or anybody is it does those three things.
So the last one is you understand.
The last one, I am being with you. The last one, it'd be hard to do right the second, but I'd be actually engaged with you when we're like writing, and we are, if you did fMRIs on the two of us, we're in the same brain state. Mm-hmm. If you're doing fMRIs on us now, I'm in a different brain state than you are. And that's fine. You still are going to feel some sorts of connection with me, because again, the connection is what creates the safety, is what creates competence, motivations, and a secure sense of me in this we. But bimonic, and you're not 100% of the time going to be bimonic, and that's fine. You need to, it's separately together. So you had a question. Somebody had a hand up, or was that just a good stretch? Oh, it was a good stretch. It's a good way of taking care of yourself. Any other thoughts? That was really unique. Yes?
In your sessions that you have with kids, have some of them never even gone over to the toys?
No.
No, they don't.
I will have, it's one out of, not even one out of 25, I guess one out of 50, it's a 10 number, will need mom to come in, or dad. No, kindly look, but my office is like this, only, I wouldn't say tenfold, but you walk in, I mean, there's this huge monkey and this bear, and it is so child, not just friendly, child inviting. It's like, here you are. So they're usually like, wow. Now, sometimes it's a little overwhelming. They have to kind of go, well, let's see. Oh, I'll go with this first. And then they start moving into that now. And sometimes we need mom, and that's fine. I mean, more and more, I really do mean it. It's team Dylan. We are a team, Mom. We are a team, Dad. Even if you're divorced, even if you hate each other, we are a team. And you're my co-therapists. Sometimes directly in here, more certainly out in the world. I more and more tell parents what they need to do. I send them those tapes I sent you. I want you to do that with your kid. By the way, I want you to do that with your kids. You have kids, you do this with them, please, at least once a week, 15 minutes. You can't do more than 30, because you won't be able to do this for more than 30 minutes. But please give them at least 15 minutes. Think, feel, say anything, do just about anything. Cell phone's off, everything's off. It's we, me, baby, we are right here. And I am so here for you, and I will witness you, and I'll help you define who you are, and I'll be mnemonic with you. I mean, come on. It's like getting a B12 shot. Yes! And that's what I mean by the vitamin supplement function of this. It's like, yes, oh my gosh. Boy, this is a wee me, and I get to really define. Please comment.
I was wondering if you found this to be true, because we do a reflective team where the whole team watches a session. And
uh-huh.
I had it, my first time doing that at Brady's, I had a really shy uh-huh. girl, and we were playing this game, and like three cards in, one of the cards said it was a thinking feeling, one of those games,
huh?
And the card said, get up and walk around the room, like one counterpart, and I was like, what's the point of this card? But we did it,
uh-huh.
And we walked around, and everything changed after that. She opened up, and I was like, oh, that's the point of it. It loosened her up, and then I started using that in the future, not the cards, but just being like, okay, let's get up and stretch and just move around, and it really makes a difference.
Of course.
It brings them out of their shell, I think.
Makes total sense. I mean, two parts to the game. Again, I'm always thinking now brain state. What brain state are we in? Like with him, I'm thinking, pumpkin. He has a right to whatever state he has. And again, I unfortunately have an agenda here. Never mind trying to get him, but also just his well-being. That's not a happy state to be in, especially when he started crying. This is not a good state. How do I help him out of this? Because what was clear and this is interesting. One of the criticisms, if you want to put it that, when we said about what we like or not so hot about humanism, there's an aspect, again, empathy is not in the empathizer. It's in the empathizee. I don't think he experienced me as all that empathic. I mean, maybe moments. But my saying to him, oh, I see you're so upset, oh, pumpkin. Well, it's better than saying, hey, kid, come out of it. Snap out of it right now. I mean, that's not going to be helpful. But even in my saying, I see you're really upset, blah, 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 doesn't really move him out of that state. I think it comforts, I think it's kind of that harbor, but sometimes we do get limbic locked. We are locked in a state. And we need to, you know, woof, let's do a few jumping jacks, and let's la 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 la. See, I'm starting to feel my brain state change. It's weird because first it's kind of like, this is playful, and then I did have a little flush, a little like, ooh, this is kind of embarrassing, this is ridiculous. Paul Connie, you're going a little beyond that boundary, even for you, there's that boundary out there somewhere. You go, this is ludicrous, never mind embarrassing yourself, it's like putting them in an awkward position, so root. But you're right, it changes the brain state, and it's back to the body wisdom. If you can move into your body, And when you're down, sometimes getting up is really good. And when you're up, I say, get on the ground. Get in a corner. Three in, five out. Because you sit like this and you're up and you're already angry, that's not a good position. You have a comment or a thought?
It follows the studies they've done about people who are unhappy, and they've done studies that If they practice smiling as artificial as
oh, of course.
That sounds,
of course.
That changes their state just by practicing it, even if they're not really into it initially, it will over time make a difference.
Absolutely. I did a little section about body, about how the body speaks. If I stand like this, it feels totally different than if I stand like this. It feels different, and you take that off. The body does speak first. Again, you don't go, ouch. You go, ouch. The body speaks first. And if you watch people, they'll kind of go, huh? And then they'll make the comment. It's first in the body. So we can shift. I mean, again, the body therapists really know this. You know, to be Reikian or whatever, but those folks really know that. So, again, if it's about who you're going to choose to be in this moment, what aspect of yourself, it's in how you move, how you think, and how you act and be in the world. And you can make a choice about that. And you as a therapist, can, if your job is to help them take loving, responsible, respectful care of themselves, how can little Dylan do that right now? And if he's at the max of his capacity, you're a consultant. And you get to say, because it became clear, I thought, nothing's going to work. The best way he can take care of himself, leave. Absolutely, you should have that choice. But I don't really know this kid, so I asked Jan, you know, what do you think? What should we do here? But the theme is, because while I do have my agenda, a higher agenda, of course, is his well-being, of course. So what's the, but it was interesting to me that he didn't just get up right away, and it might be that overwhelm factor of, oh my God, I have to go through this gauntlet of these people, oh my God. I don't know. I also, what I didn't want for him is that he would feel disappointed that, in himself somehow, that, oh, I didn't get myself to play with these toys. That I wouldn't want for him. I don't think he did that, but it wouldn't be too surprising if by the time, actually, I'm so sorry, I do want to hear you, but just one sec. What happened, you took him down to the parking lot? Did he change? What happened for him? Okay.
Walking down the stairs, and then when we got to like out in the open, we started talking about how pretty it was outside. And we got a flower, and we sniffed the flower, and then Jan started talking about, we're going to get you a treat because you were so brave, and he was like,
perfect.
Yeah,
hi there.
Hey, good morning.
Good morning.
Any chance did anybody find a wallet this morning?
Oh. No.
There's a jacket here that was left, though.
Sergey?
There's a jacket and an umbrella. Oh, okay.
That's why I already called them.
Oh, they didn't know?
No.
So sorry. Black, brown? Well, it's a wallet. It doesn't matter. We'll figure it out. All right, we will kind of, you betcha. Sorry. So he shifted again. He shifted brain states.
Yeah.
The good news is he perceived himself as being brave.
Yeah.
So that's good.
And then he even said, bye.
Okay, yeah. I mean, one of the wonderful things about kids in particular, of course, never mind the rest, is how quickly they can shift.
Yeah. And I think maybe, like, just it kind of felt like claustrophobic in here, just because it's a long class. Because he was still sad when we were going down the stairs, and then right when we went out to the open, like, it seemed like he was like, oh, geez. Like, I felt like he
Brick walls. I mean, he has a right to. Total right and understand why he feels like he does. It is different than I've experienced kids. I mean, like, again, they'll be shy, they'll start out, and then they usually just the magic mind takes over. Yeah. You actually still have a couple. Why don't you go and then you go ahead?
I was just wondering do you think it would have been different if we had all stepped out and let him kind of get acclimated and play just with Jan or maybe Jan and you, and then just trickled in one at a time after maybe 10 minutes?
Yeah, maybe. My fantasy is it's less this and more kind of this and me, you know, nothing personal to me, but, you know, there's a certain intensity. It is also, usually not with kids this young, but I might have told you, when I was at Davis, you know, the Carl tape, during that time, I had a client who was, he was probably about 10, and again, I'm just freshly stalacciated, so to speak. I was total stalic. I'm doing the reflections. I don't know about the trait thing so much. And I remember this one, he was 9 or 10. And he literally ended up kind of almost fetalized in the corner of the room. And I realized in my saying, maybe this is too intense for you, this is really difficult, that in itself is like a magnifying glass in the sun. This was not a safety-inducing experience for him. It's too much focus on me, meaning the you, me, not me, in this we-ness. And for him, that was really intrusive. It can be very intrusive. And so I said, you look so uncomfortable. What would you like to do? He said, can we go outside and shoot baskets? And I said, absolutely. And similar in that, you know, he gets outside, he's like, Now, usually little pumpkins, again, they flourish and thrive. They love this stuff. But I don't know. I don't know if this was just too intense. So I'm thinking it was less you folks. So, you know, but again, he's over here. This is his reality for the most part. And you guys were nicely quiet and whatever. So you had a comment or question or whatever.
Yeah, when you were talking about, like, in your practice, when parents coming in, how many sessions do you usually that for, you know, especially with a really shy child and not yet comfortable.
Oh, it's rarely more than two. And a lot,
is like the parent in there the whole time for like the first two?
Or usually by the Let's see, let me think it through. So I had one where I wanted to work with the two of them. And it wasn't even filial therapy in the formal sense, which we'll get to about 4 weeks from now, where you really train the parent in doing this and you modeled and all that. It wasn't that. But she just became part of the treatment and it was useful. Usually it's one or two times. They'll come in. The first time, sometimes they'll be there. And I also want them. They're also checking me out. They're trusting me with their little kid. And, you know, it's a world out there now. So we pay. And that's fine. And I want them to see how I am. I want them to do this. I want them to learn how to be reflective and child-centered and all this stuff. So I'm happy with that. And sometimes I'll pause and I'll tell them, you know, what I'm doing, why I'm doing. I now almost universally, for any parent with a kid who's six and under, until we're six, I will tell them, I want you to do this. It'll be really good for your kid if you would do this. And as I said, I send them Scott Stolich's book, which is a little stuffy for a lot of folks, frankly. It's a little too researchy-ish or whatever. I will send them the videos that I sent you, including the one of the boy and girl that I showed you the girl part last time. And I'll tell them to do that. So usually by the second session, if we're really going to do some individual work, because that's also good in a different new we-ness, I will say, so you got that phone call to make, right, Mom? And they get it, and they go, yeah, I got to make a phone call. Now watch the kid. If the kid's like, oh, where are you going? I ain't going to do that. Most of the kids by then are totally in there, and that's fine. And I'll say, Mom, we'll be in the waiting room. I had one kid who liked the door a little open between my waiting room and the office, and that's fine. But usually they just melt away. And sometimes what's interesting, and again, dynamics and systems, it's a little hard for the parent to let the kid really want, especially when there's separation anxiety and all that. And that's when you want the kid to have at least another space. Remember I told you my little Asian boy, right? The one who spoke English but refused. Just the fact that he would be alone in an office in and of itself was healing for this kid in terms of the treatment goal of being able to be a little more of a me in this we-ness thing. But sometimes it's hard for that. I have one parent where she's like, you okay in there?
Yeah.
And the kid's like, it's not even thinking that she's like totally absorbed in what they're doing. And I'll say, I know it's hard for you, Mom, yeah, as well as for them.
And my so mom, she keeps checking, she's like, so I'm leaving now.
Yeah.
Everything okay?
Right.
Like, yes.
Yeah. You can go now. So there's that flip side of it. And I also have parents model. I mean, again, one of the things that seems bizarre about Stolich's stuff, and he even owns that, says, I know this, that's a, I am now going to, and he'll say, do a bowel movement. I'd say, go poop. But he will say, I'm going to go do a bowel, and you say it out loud, and the kid comes in. Again, the kid's not 13, because he'd be calling CPS if the parent's doing that. The kid's a little 3-year-old, a little 2-year-old. I'm now sitting on the toilet seat. Grunt, grunt. I'm not, you know, you're again a video camera with heart on yourself. It's kind of strange. But I certainly have them do that when they're at the traffic light. You know, I have an impulse control problem type kid. You know, my 4-part protocol. Why am I going to do what I'm doing? What is the impact of my actions? What do I need to do instead? And if you've offended, you amend. So I tell the parent, you're in the stoplight. The guy in front of you is not moving, and the light is green. You say out loud, light's green, the guy's not moving. I'm feeling like just honking my horn and screaming at this guy. But if I do that, it's just going to bum my eyes, going to get mad. I'm just like getting all upset. So instead, I'll listen to the radio. Oh, I'm feeling better now. Oh, you moved. Say it out loud. Really? Yes. Model for him at least once a day. God, this pot won't come up. I feel like just dumping the whole thing. But if I do, it's going to make such a mess. I'm going to have to clean it all up. So instead, I'm just going to patiently, oh, I see if I tune it down. Oh, it worked. They absorb it. And that's how, I'm now calling it control aesthetics. You know calisthenics? Mm-hmm. Control aesthetics. We gotta do control aesthetics. Practice being in charge of hands, feet, and mouth, mind, and mood. But like isometrics, controlometrics. You gotta be in charge. But I'm very actively using parents more and more, especially capable ones who can do this. Okay, I'm waiting for the next little pumpkin. While we're on parents, let me tell you a couple of parent stories. Because it's, for me, frankly, the hardest work is with the parents, not with the kids. I love the kids. Kids are easy in a way. I mean, they are. They're just, They're there, they're here. I mean, sometimes old pumpkins have, but I don't have a kid like that in therapy where he's terrified of coming in. So parents can be very difficult. Let me give you some of my failures. Here's my greatest failure. Because you've got to make an alliance with the parent. You've got to make an alliance. They have the power. They have the power. They're not going to bring the kid unless you have an alliance with them. And it's hard, by the way, of course, in divorce cases, because they each want you to side against the other parent. And I'll tell them, I promise you, I will never say anything negative about you in front of or with the other parent. I will never collude against you with the other parent. I promise. And I'll say that to the other parent about the same thing, same spiel. And if and when, I really do this, I have two chairs in my office for the grown-ups, faces the pretty view of the cove. Here's all the, I probably should take a picture of this so you get a sense of that. So when I'm seeing one parent, touch base, because I usually will touch base for 5 minutes, just give me what's new if they haven't emailed me. If somehow they talk about the other parent and I'm going to make some comment, I look at the other chair as if the parent is there. I really will. And I'll say, I know it's weird, but I promise when you're not here, you are here in that chair. In fact, I did that yesterday. Unfortunately, the guy sat where he usually does and not where the mom did, so I can turn. I say, by the way, she usually does sit over here. So I can say, and Mom, I know how hard it must be for you to deal with it. In part, I'm modeling for him. There's another way to look at this, because again, they are amygdalated. So they are narrow in perception, only going to be negative. They're going to assume the negative about the other parent. So I'm going to try in a different way, but also it teaches them I'm never going to collude against the other. So that part's hard. And they'll look at you, and you're supposed to nod like, yeah, that son of a bitch. Really unbelievable. God, maybe I should be calling CPS. That's ridiculous. And I won't. I think when I do custody vows, it's the other thing in my introduction. I'll say, I know you're going to tell me horrible things about the other person. The more horrible it is, the more I'm going to go poker face. It doesn't mean I'm not empathic. Doesn't mean I don't agree or disagree. I don't know. In that moment, I'm a fact finder. So I'm going to be computerized in a sense. I'm an animated screen that just kind of takes the information in. But don't interpret that as I don't care or it's not important what you're saying or I'm discounting what you're saying. That's not what's going on. But just know that. So I tell them that. Okay. So I get this call. Hi, Dr. Volcani. I've heard such great things about you. You're the only therapist that I want my kid to see. You're the best in the, blah, 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 blah. Now, of course, what is the first thing you say after your internalized narcissist kind of goes, oh, really? Except I really don't have it. Sorry?
They want something from you.
Well, there's two parts. First of all, again, you got to remember. Oh, by the way, is this a divorce situation? That's the first thing you got to do. You got to do that, ladies and gentlemen. In fact, just yesterday, truly, honestly, don't just say that, by the way. A parent calls me, and it turns out years ago I did a custody eval. So they say, oh, the kids really want to go to you. They say, we want to go see Dr. Volcano. Because they don't like the current therapist. And I thank God for the digital age where I can quickly do the little search and find these people and go, oh, I did a custody eval. I can't see them in therapy. So I said, thank you very much. I'm glad the kids had a good time and remember me. But I couldn't possibly do the therapy. But by the way, you'd have to consent from both parents. And what he says to me is, oh, well, wait a minute. The current therapist didn't get my consent. And she just took him to this therapist. And I said, good look. That's a good look. Close. Oh, camera, you should be right there on that face. You should be the poster person for, oh, no, that was really bad. Don't do that. You should put, without that. I was like, really? And again, I don't want to diss any other therapist. It's not my job to diss somebody. But I said, oh, well, maybe they're not familiar with the whole issue of divorce. And some people think joint legal means either parent can bring. That is absolutely not the case. No, you had to get a sign. That therapist had to get a signed consent from you before, blah, 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 blah. He was like, oh, well, and he felt very empowered anyway. And that was just yesterday. All right, so I get the call. So I say, oh, is it a divorce situation? She says, no, my husband's deceased. Wow, oh, okay, wow, okay. But you're the only one who can see him, blah, 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 blah. He has seen several other therapists. Okay, okay, okay. So then I meet with her, and she's a very intense woman. I'm going to want you to kind of guess the possible DX. I mean, in all due respects to Barry Graff, you remember Barry Graff's diagnosis for all human beings he sees? What is it?
Human.
Thank you, human being. That was your clue. For all human being he sees, human being. Oh, speaking of that, who's going to write the question for today? Somebody write the question. You'll write the question for today. So we have the interview. So her husband died, and he died of cancer. And what happened was, he was at straight up to one of the hospitals here, but she wanted a better hospital. First, this was the best hospital, but now it was not a good hospital at all. In fact, it was an evil, bad hospital. So she found the best hospital in the world, which was in Minnesota or someplace. So she is going to fly him out. She's going to pull him out and fly him there because that's the best hospital in the world.
This is the kid or the dad?
I'm so sorry. Thank you for... It's the dad. It's the dad, in case I'm obviously not being clear. This is my first interview with her. Okay, okay, what happened? Well, the docs told me, first of all, you're going to sign 13 volumes of papers that say this is against medical advice. And furthermore, he will die on the way there. He will not make it to that hospital. Oh yes, he will. You guys are just money grabbers and that's all you care about, blah, 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 blah. So of course, what happens? Correct, he dies in flight. A little inconvenient for the rest of the passengers. He dies in flight. I think they landed there and they didn't come back. Anyway, so understandably, she also harbors a lot of guilt. A footnote on that. The way she knew of me, frankly, was from the former student in the class. And that student told her a bunch of things about me, including that I was into Jung. And when we get to Jung, we'll get into some wooga wooga stuff. That's one of the things. Technical term, I know you can handle it. Some wooga wooga stuff. Including, you know, maybe, I don't know, psychic phenomena, whatever all that is. So she knew that I knew of a psychic. Because I do. Really, really good psychic, though. I don't know if they're around anymore. But we'll get there. So this woman contacted that psychic so that she could talk to or have some connection with her husband, because she felt very, very guilty. But, so here we're getting the, okay, let's see, she loves this and they're the best, and then, oh, they're terrible, and we're going to find the other best. Husband dies. Well, the kid has been to at least 3 or 4 therapists. Now I'm the latest idealized one. What might you be thinking diagnostically, in all due respect to Barry Graff? Yes! Oh my God! So in that interview, I say to her, there might come a time when the old clay feet appear without shoes. All I ask, if that would happen, that I would have 3 sessions with this young lad, because I'm going to form an attachment to it. We're going to connect. This is how I work. And I was really even more about connection as opposed to connection and skill acquisition. I was very much a purist. You just do this, you connect. Skills will come, they'll figure it out, but this is what matters. So I'm going to embed, this is going to be really important. And oh, by the way, that's right, this kid has lost his dad. Oh, okay, and I'm kind of a replacement father. I mean, this is huge stuff! So please, Ms. Borderline, because I know you're going to vilify me some point down the road. We all know this. Give me 3. Give me 3 sessions, just 3 more sessions. Different song. Before I walk out the door, before you walk out the door. Hopefully without the... Do you know the song, by the way? Yeah. Give me 3 steps. Give me 3 steps, mister. Give me 3 sessions. Give me 3 steps, Ms., before you walk out that door. We're good for about 9 sessions of idealization. I'm the best. I'm the best. This kid is an incredible kid. And she... And I don't use this word lightly. She loathes this kid. She loathes him. I mean, you can just see it in her visage. You don't have to have the 300ths of a millisecond to look at her and know how much she... I mean, talk about the bad object. She has dumped all of that on this little pumpkin. He's about 8. And he's just... I mean, talk about bottoming it down. He comes in. He's a handsome lad. Way before your time was a guy named Omar Sharif. Yeah, look at the light. Boy, camera on that face. That's fantastic. He was in Dr. Zhivago. I mean, gorgeous man. Well, this kid like was a little miniature Omar Sharif. He was like a very young Omar Sharif. Interesting. Laura! One of the most famous scenes in all movies. Laura! If you've never seen Dr. Zhivago, even this high-tech edge, see Dr. Zhivago once. Unfortunately, he has a younger brother. I can't remember, Arnie, I think. Arnie, my little Arnie. Oh, God, talk about split object. Jesus, you could be a supermarket clerk. No offense to that profession or anything like that, but I know nothing about psychology per se in any formal sense. Go, wow, this woman really, really loves a lot this kid and really, really hates this kid. That's unusual. What do you guys call that? Splitting? Oh my God. So this poor kid is in the middle of that. She hates him. She hates the way he eats. Can you teach him how to eat properly? He eats and the mashed potato like sticks out, and she'll say this in front of him. Oh, it's disgusting. Look at that. I love these myriad, but they poor punk. Okay, I'm trying to build this because you can see where this goes. Session 9, something like that. Again, I meet with him. I meet with, I meet with her a little bit, but she wants him to come in. Okay, fine, because she wants to castigate him in front of me. Try to buffer that, try to model, whatevers. And then I meet with him individually. He is sitting in the big bear. I had this big, you'll see it in the, one of the things, a big panda bear. And he's sitting in the panda bear's lap. And she's sitting in the chair. And she's talking, I don't know if it was about the food or whatever, or whatever. Dragon. This dragon, this guy's too cute for the part, but it's kind of like. He says to her, there's a reason I'm doing this, obviously. He says to her, in this courageously kind of muted, trepidationated, not a word, voice, Mommy, could you get, you're missing a key part, but that's okay. Mommy, I think you don't love me. Oh my God, that was so heroic of him. And he's just, I mean, in tears, he just can't hold it. He's just, and he, she says, she looks at him, of course, with great scorn, unlike you with your marvelous mirror neurons, and says, what? How can you say that? And I look at her and say, well, you know, when you say to him, you disgust me, about things like the mashed potato, I can imagine how he might feel as if you don't love him. This is representing putting your foot in your mouth. That's why I have this. I can't, I'm not flexible enough to do this. I admire, envy those of you lovely limber ladies who can do that. It's amazing. She looks at me, doesn't say a word, gets up, grabs him and says, we're going. Just like that, just like that. Out the door. Yeah, shock look. I'm like, oh my God. Okay, I'll see you next Tuesday. No, you won't. Another song way before your time. It's all over now, baby blue. Bob Dylan. Obviously, so I call. They don't pick up the phone. This is way before texting or anything like that. There is no contact. Obviously, I saved the Tuesday time just in case. Obviously, they don't come. And I told her that I'll save the Tuesday time, blah, blah, blah. I mean, becoming a phone stalker at this point. I'm like, come on, come on, come on. And I even say, you know, it's fine. I'd say, you remember we talked about the 3 sessions? Listen, just 1 session. By the way, I won't charge you. It's really important for this kid. He's lost his dad. He and I, by the way, did have a really good. My dad, by the way, I do think, have a witness, have a help you define yourself, evoke the courageous one inside of you, because you got your cohort here, and that's why I do think he would never have said that to her in any other context. So proof in putting in that sense. Finally, she picks up the phone. She says, look, let me be clear, you will never have any contact with this kid whatsoever. No, you can't talk to him on the phone right now. And I said, somebody, I'll light him on the lighter, just a good minor. No, can't do anything like that ever again. Don't ever contact us at all. Fair enough. Click. Now, along the line, I know it's a long story, along the lines, because she was so focused on manners and all that, there was a student, former student, who was fantastic in all the behavioral charts and all that behavioral stuff, which I now, in fact, have incorporated more, but in those I didn't at all. And I thought, you know, we could work together. She could work on the manners. I can work on the soul. I like this. This is good. And the mom liked it. So, oh, okay. I said, you know, it works faster. Again, to eat tidy and neat and all that other stuff. So, about 2 months earlier to this departure, a student who was a psych assistant got on board and was doing that. So that's great. They were working together as were. Of course, when she left, ever so abruptly, of course you know what happened. She idealizes, rightfully, and that's fine. Now the other religion. And that's fine. The Volcani's an idiot, unbelievable, it's horrible, it's terrible, you're wonderful, blah, 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 blah. So I did hear from a student. She said, you know, now I hear, blah, blah, blah. About 3 months later, student calls me. Not only is she suing me, she's suing my supervisor. I'm so sorry. I promise someday I'll send you 3 really good referrals who are non-borderline for the damage I've done. I'm so sorry to the student. Yeah. Never heard from him since. That poor kid. Oh my God. Set up. I mean, how is he gonna integrate never mind a positive me, but a positive sense of women and relationships? If it's about self, other, and the world, how is he going to do that? So, point being, obviously, I don't care how skilled you are or whatever you are. There are times when it ain't gonna work. Let me give you one other time, then we're gonna take a break, because then hopefully this kid will come. The reason I got back into, pardon me, is I took karate many, many years ago when I was in college. I love it. And then I got busy, and then I took some in the summer, and then I went to Michigan State. I took it again. Came back here, got very busy in my life, and I stopped taking it, because if you're going to do it, you really got to do this thing. There was a dojo right up the street. When I walk, I'd see it, and there was the teacher there, and he says, I see you keep peering in here. I said, yeah, I took karate for years, and I love it. Why don't you join? I said, look, I know what it is. I'm not going to come here for 3 months. I'm going to come here forever now, 2 or 3 times a week. There's no way I can make that commitment. Okay, fast forward. I get a call from the courts to do a reunification therapy. 10-year-old boy and his dad that he hasn't seen in 5 years. Former biker, heavy guy, bad guy, tattoo, you know, all that stuff. Nothing wrong with tattoos. If you have them, congratulations. I have a story about a tattoo, but I'm not going to go there. I'm going to stay on this road. Heavy drug user, all the usual history. But it's been 5 years. He's been individual therapy. He's gone through all the hoops. He's ready to go. He wants to see his kid. Okay, courts have ordered it. Okay. Kid obviously with mom and stepdad. Kid is terrified of this guy. So again, the way I do unification therapy, I meet with, in this case, the dad once individually, twice if I need to. I love my kid. The mom's awful. She's kept him away. All the usual stuff. Okay, I love that look. Like, yeah. Okay, that could also be true. All truths are also possible. I love him. Mijo. Isn't that Spanish for like my dear, whatever? Mijo. No. Okay, cool. I try to help him out. You know, it's about the heart. I know you haven't seen in a long time. It's about connecting. He's going to be scared. You're going to reflect that. You're going to show him you're not the evil, awful one that mom says that you are. The best way to contact is be different. Of course. Okay, Mr. Biker Man, you're all set. Meet mom and stepdad. The guy's awful, terrible, horrible, violent. He's never going to change, never has changed, blah, blah, blah. Okay. Meet the kid. I'm scared. It's going to be okay. Promise. Dad. Kid. Stepdad in waiting room. Dad looks at him. Mijo, I've missed you. I've missed you. Look at how big you are. Look at how handsome you are. Ah, so good to see you. Gosh. Kid's like, he's like, he makes this kid look like he's bouncing in joy. He's in ebullience compared to how this kid was like, oh my God. He's one step away from urinating on himself. He's that scared. time, man. So I said, Dad, you look a little nervous. I'm like, Dad, come on, reflect. You're looking a little nervous. Hey, I'm sorry if I've done anything to make you scared. Come on, we can do this. And Dad's looking at him. So he looks scared. So that's the best he could do. He looks scared. Now he's probably feeling even more scared. You look even more scared. So how come, did you get my letters? How come you never answered back? How come you never answered back? All the letters. Wait, Dad. Dad, I know how much you love your kid. I know how much you want to bridge with this kid. Yelling about it. Quote, shut the fuck up. I said, oh, this isn't going to work. Shut up and sit down. I'm so sorry. This isn't going to work. Session over. Come on. The kid now is like, come on up. And so he's like, God damn you. And the stepdad is in the waiting room. Stepdad gets up and says, are you through abusing my kid? Oh my God, it's plastique and now we've got the starter bomb or however that works. Oh my God, the cell phone timer, whatever all that stuff is. I'm like, oh my God. So, and this guy, oh by the way, this guy's huge. If you didn't catch that, his arms are Lisa's and I got little legs. He's got big legs. Nah, that's not right. But you know, it's like, oh my God. And he's in this, talk about limbic lock, he's in a total altered state. You know how the woman can pick up the V-dub of the grandson's under it? This guy could pick up a Mack truck with his little left pinky. So I just said, and this is, by the way, if you know the area, Crab Catcher, La Jolla, California. You know, my office used to be above the Crab Catcher. Very public area. So I think, okay, we'll get. So I tell the stepdad and the kid, leave. So they leave, and the guy's following them. Hulk. And I guess Hulk was at least good, I think. Sort of. Yeah, Hulk's good. Evil Hulk. Dark side of Hulk. Remember the dark Spider-Man? This is Dark Hulk. He's all black. No offense to black. Boy, you can't do anything. You can't do anything without stepping on somebody's toes somewhere. Jesus. Politically correct world. Just be mute. But then you're offending the deaf or the mute. I mean, you know, not the deaf, the mute. I don't know. Anyway, stop all that. So, I'll never forget this moment. Oh my God. So stepdad and kid are now up the stairs, and now on Prospect. They're still yelling at each other. And I say to Hulk, come back in the office. Come on. So he turns around, and his pupils are totally dilated. He's in a total altered state. And then he looks at me and goes, it's all your fucking fault. It's all your fucking fault. And I start backing up, and everything starts to go slow. Motion, because my synapses are firing so fast. That's how you get some motion, right? Fast frames, all shot. Really slow. I'm in the Matrix, and this was way before the Matrix ever came out. And wish I could be in the Matrix dodging this guy. Oh my God. I thought, oh my God, he is going to kill me. Oh my God. He's coming at me. Now, as you well know, fortunately, therapists have side doors. So as with much dignity as possible, I looked at him and I said, see ya. And now, how do you run for your life with dignity? Because I didn't want to give him satisfaction. No, I'm like, fuck, you're crazy and you're going to kill me. Get the fuck out of here. And I run out that way. He goes out the door and says, I'm coming back with a gun and I'm going to kill your ass. Oh, my God. What do? I call the police. Well, if he kills you, we'll come do something. Thank you. This confidentiality, danger to self, other. Oh, I can report this. Okay, I can tell you his name. They said you could hire a guard. Because I was going to see clients this was in the morning. I was going to see clients in the afternoon. So never mind my safety. What about the client? What do I do? I cancel my, I don't know what to do. My inner, oh my God, came out. So police, that's not going to help. I call his therapist. She goes, he's all mouth, he's no action. Okay, easy for you to say. But I saw some action coming at me. I saw about 280 pounds of action coming at me in an altered state. I'll call him. Let's face the dragon. Call him directly. It's me. Actually, I had a gun in my back pocket. The only reason I didn't shoot you is because I didn't want to shoot you in the back, you wimp. God. But I was shooting as I drove by. okay, well, I'm glad you didn't shoot me. I appreciate that. And then it suddenly, it was unbelievable. He says, I'm not going to kill your ass. Fuck you. And he hung up. I thought, great. I suddenly thought, this guy could, and this is weird, could take away my seeing Tron graduate. This guy could take away my going to Grant's graduation. This guy could take away my holding my grandson. Fuck that! I am never going to be ever that vulnerable in my life. And that day I went and signed up, and I've been going to karate ever since. I am never going to be, that vulnerable ever again. Ever. And I'm not. I have a lot more skills and options. God forbid if anybody ever comes at me or comes at anybody I care about. I have a lot of skills and options as to what I could do. And that, I can't imagine, frankly, being a woman. Oh, thank you, yes! And that's my story now. That's good. It's like a group. And what's your name? Right here. Wimps Anonymous. But now the inner courageous one has come out. I am buff. I am tough. Don't mess with me. Anyway, by the way, I still, if I was in that exact situation with him, I probably still would daintily run. That's probably by far the best option. But if I couldn't run and has me up against the wall, oh, do I have some options. My comment would probably be, how badly do you want me to hurt you? It's not a matter of whether you're going to get hurt. It's how bad. I can kill you, or I can maim you, or I can just get you on the ground. You choose which one of those options, because one of them is going to happen if you continue to do what you do. And I mean that. Boy, that's tough, huh? I'm tough. I don't know if you know, I'm a fourth degree black belt. Okay, so I can break three boards with a good kick on a good day. And two boards with it. And that is quite, it's quite a feeling to go, bam, and the thing shatters. And it's very humbling when you go, bam, and it doesn't. That's okay. There's another day. And you really do, one of the things I love about karate, you really do have to have, be eunuchic in that moment. If you're going to break three boards, it's thwarta. Or even two with a fist. You have to be connected to mind, body, and spirit. And go into, she has to leave, it's okay. And go into that space, and that's a fabulous space to be in. So anyway, there's my stories. It can be tough out there. You're heroes to even take it on. Let's take a break. I'm expecting Little Pumpkin to be here soon. So let's take just a 10-minute break. Perfect.